Right. So this only needs to exist like in the vicinity of the conformal boundary, and there are theorems that, like in asymptotic, at least in the Euclidean case, like you can always do that. Right. So now what we do is like we want to rephrase this action in terms of these new variables. So you can just, this is like an exercise if you want. So you can decompose the bulk Ricci scalar in the following form. Where this vector and nu is can be expressed. So it has like the radial component is 1 over n, and the transverse component is minus ni over n. And it's normalized. So it's a unit. So you can compute the norm using this metric, and you see that it's normalized. And the orientation is that such that it is outward. So it's like a long increasing radial coordinate. So, and here also, so k, remember it was the term that appears here. This is the trace of this tensor. So this is the extrinsic curvature. And it takes the form gamma dot ij minus ij minus ni, where dot is defined to be the radial derivative here. Right, so now using this expression here, and if we just plug it in here, you can easily verify that we get, you can write the action so as a radial integral over a Lagrangian density, and this Lagrangian density is the following. And notice here that it's crucial, like in order to formulate the problem in this Hamiltonian language, it's crucial to have this Gibbons-Hawking term. So what this Gibbons-Hawking term does is it cancels precisely this total derivative term here. So in particular, if you do the calculation, you will see actually that this term is, once you pull it back like on the hypersurface, actually this term is identically zero, and it only cancels this. So this term here cancels the Gibbons-Hawking term. So that's why you can write as an integral over this Lagrangian density. Right, so this is the Lagrangian. So we can do a Legendre. Okay, before the Legendre transform, let's compute the canonical momenta. So the canonical momenta, if you recall from classical mechanics, is defined as the derivative of the Lagrangian with respect to the velocities. So in this case, so the momentum of the metric is this. And then there is also an important observation that you see here in this Lagrangian. So remember k, like from this expression here, has a first order derivative in the radial coordinate, so in this kind of Hamiltonian time. So when we, but this Lagrangian here, it does not have any, it does not depend on n. Actually, sorry, it depends only on n here. So there is an n here and there. So, so basically, now if you compute the canonical momenta, so pi of n is, is the derivative with respect to n dot, and it's identically zero. And the same for pi n I. And this is also identically zero. So this implies that n and n I are Lagrange multipliers. So they are non-dynamical fields. So they are kind of auxiliary fields. Sorry? The monitor, sorry, yes.
It's just gone up.
Okay, sure, thank you. Ah, it removed that. I see. Okay.
Oh, sorry, do you need that?
Well, not, for now it's okay. No, it's fine. Thanks. Right, okay. So now that we have like the Lagrangian density and the corresponding momenta, we can do the Lezen transform to obtain the Hamiltonian. So the Hamiltonian is given, we have to sum over all the canonical momenta, but since only one of them is non-trivial, so we just have this expression here, minus L. And then if you plug explicitly this expression here for the Lagrange density, and you invert this expression here, so, right, so now you can combine this, right? I mean, you can, this expression here, you can invert this expression for the extrinsic curvature to write in terms of the canonical momentum, and then we plug it back there. So if you do that, then you can express the Hamiltonian in this form, plus nihi, where this h and hi are the following. Right, so this is like what you get from this calculation. But now you see that, remember that this n and n I, they are Lagrange multipliers, so the corresponding Hamilton equations imply that these have to vanish identically, right? For n and n I, apply the constraints hi is equal to 0. So this constraint, the fact that h has to vanish is the Hamiltonian constraint, and this is sometimes referred to as the momentum constraint. Sorry, here, this is like an overall n. So ni appears only inside here the extrinsic curvature.
Yeah.
But there is no, so these derivatives are, I didn't mention, sorry. Yeah, sorry. So this covariant derivative here is, di is covariant with respect to the induced metric gamma ij. Okay, so now, so here, before I continue like with this Hamiltonian description, I'll just make a side comment because it will be useful later on. So, and this is the Hamilton-Jacobi so the Hamilton-Jacobi formalism, like probably you're familiar again, like from classical mechanics, but now you can, like essentially, like very briefly, I mean, what it amounts to is expressed in the canonical momentum, not as a derivative of the off-cell Lagrangian with respect to the corresponding velocity, but rather as a derivative of this functional S of gamma with respect to gamma ij. So notice there is no radial derivative here. So it's not the velocity, it's just like the field itself. So this S is related, like if you remember from classical mechanics, this S is called like Hamilton's principal function. And it is up to some constants, it is equivalent, is equal to the on selection. So I don't have time to derive this like from scratch. So it's the same derivation that you have like in classical mechanics. So now it just like you apply it just to this Hamiltonian field theory. But now once you write the canonical momenta in this form, you can go back to these expressions here, and then you you can use the constraints to obtain some equations. So the Hamiltonian constraint, it tells us that we get. So you can plug it in. So maybe I just write the first terms here. So you get gamma I k gamma k l, and then you get the other term minus. And then you get one more term, so this one more equation, which is basically the conservation of the derivative of this S with respect to gamma. So, and these two are the so-called Hamilton Hamilton-Jacobi equations for gravity. So, and just a side comment again, and a second side comment that is related. So notice that now we have two expressions here for the canonical momentum. So one is this Hamilton-Jacobi expression, and the other one was the standard Hamiltonian expression in terms of the derivative of the Lagrangian, which we found is equal to the extrinsic curvature. So so if we combine the two, so we can write something that is of this form. So it's like 2k squared, and then gamma ik, gamma gl minus. Right. So I might have missed some factors here, but so this flow equation looks like that. Now, why is this important in what we want to do? So this connects precisely to some of the points that I mentioned earlier. So here, if you actually solve this Hamilton-Jacobi equation to determine S, now why we want to do this, we will see later. But suppose you have a solution here, like of this equation, then if you plug it here, you get a first order equation for the induced field gamma. So in other words, essentially what you have done is like you have integrated once the equations of motion. So once you find the solution of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, you've integrated once the equations of motion. Now the statement about this superpotential that I made is that now if you consider like, for example, black hole solutions that don't depend like on the transverse coordinates, some kind of homogeneous solutions, then you can find exact solutions of this Hamilton-Jacobi equation. And one of the solutions will be precisely the supersymmetric superpotential, if the theory is supersymmetric and admits as a superpotential. So a very special solution of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation in supersymmetric theories is the supersymmetric superpotential. And if you plug this particular solution back into this flow equation, you will get the BPS equations of the theory. But of course, this applies more generally. So it applies to all solutions of the theory. It doesn't apply only to the supersymmetric ones. So, but in the case of non-supersymmetric solutions, solving this Hamilton-Jacobi equation is much harder. And usually the solution does not exist globally, so it exists like only locally.
Sorry, that comment went too fast. Can you please repeat it? Supersymmetric.
Right. So in supersymmetric theories, then usually there is always a solution of this Hamilton-Jacobi equation, which corresponds to the supersymmetric superpotential. However, this so if you plug this supersymmetric superpotential, so the solution here that you get, let's call it like SBPS.
What do you mean by supersymmetric superpotential?
So let's take the black hole solutions that, like Stefan was talking about earlier, like in n equal to gauge supergravity, right? I mean, so there is a superpotential that describes this, these solutions, right?
A prepotential, okay, a superpotential. He was talking about
different. Right, that's right, that's right. Yes, okay, sure. So, but I mean, you can also, like in n equal 1, let's say, right, you can have like a superpotential, okay. Right? I mean, so then this superpotential, it will be a solution of this equation. And then if you use this superpotential, like, I mean, so let's call it as BPS. So if you use this superpotential as a, like, this special solution of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation into these general first order equations, so what you will get is that these flow equations will reduce to the BPS equations. But of course, this, both the Hamilton-Jacobi equation and these first-order equations are more general than supersymmetric solutions. So they apply to all solutions. However, for non-supersymmetric solutions, in that case, it is generically very hard to solve the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, although you can do it. So there's something called like fake supergravity that like essentially boils down to this. Solving this equation for non-supersymmetric solutions. But the last point I made was like, but usually if for non-supersymmetric solutions, the Hamilton's principal function will have branch cuts in field space. So it will not be globally well-defined. So that's why, I mean, supersymmetry ensures that the solution is globally well-defined.
By SBPS, you mean like the action obtained by just F time terms or something like that? What do you exactly mean by SBPS?
So by SBPS here, I just mean the solution of this Hamilton-Jacobi equation that corresponds to...
BPS.
Yeah, so just look at the Gravitino, for example, or the right, the Gravitino equation, right? And then if you look like, I mean, this will look like... so it will give you some equation that is... like gamma dot minus like W epsilon equal to zero, right? I mean, if you demand, like, very schematically, right? I mean, something like that, right? And then from the Dilatino, let's say, I mean, you will get something like that is like phi dot minus DI phi W epsilon equal to zero, very schematically again.
I see.
So this W is a solution of this Hamilton-Jacobi equation, but it's a very specific solution.
And this first order equation, then you interpret as BPS.
Yeah, so if you plug this very special solution into these equations reduce to this.
I see.
I mean, of course, you will have another one for the scalars. You will have another of these flow equations for the scalars from the Hamilton-Jacobi construction. Any other questions about this point? Okay, so... right, so now let me... My comment is that in principle, in general, this is actually what is called like Hamilton's principal function.
Yes.
So it is any solution of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation.
Yes.
Now, it actually corresponds to, is equal to the Onsell action. You can show this, but there are some caveats. So there are some constants. So like when you integrate the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, there are some. So of course, the general solution of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation is a PDE. Generically, we have many fields. So you will get, like, I mean, functions, integration functions. However, the general solution that you need, the most general solution that you need is what is called the principal function, which contains, like, a number of integration function constants, not functions. And you need as many integration constants as the number of fields. So, however, the general solution, this principal function, will contain these integration constants. And then the point is that, like, you have to, for a very specific values of these integration constants, these will agree with the Onsell action. Right, okay, so let me bring this here. Thank you. Right, so now let's see another aspect of this formulation, which is like the symplectic. Structure. And then, so here the point is that now this space, like of momenta and fields, right? I mean, so like in classical mechanics, admit like a symplectic form. And in this case, the symplectic form is expressed in terms of these fields and the canonical momentum. So here, this is like a wedge product in the tangent space, right? I mean, of in the field space. The tangent space of the of phase space. So this is the symplectic form. You can derive it in different ways. You can also use something called like the covariant phase space formulation. So you get the same result, like if you pull it back like on a radial slice. But in any case, this is like the symplectic form of the theory. And an important property is that the radial derivative of this symplectic form is zero. It's constant. So this is crucial. And that is one of the reasons why I mentioned this caveat about the manifold here. So this is like on the radial slice. And why this radial slice has to be compact. If it's not compact, then I mean you get this is not so trivial to show. So it might not be the case without additional boundary terms here. So let me say sigma r compact. So now this, so we'll see in a moment that this is quite important. So now we can invert this, and then we can construct the corresponding Poisson bracket. So this is like the equal time Poisson bracket, where time is like this radial coordinate now. And then this Poisson bracket can be realized in the following way. So if you have like functionals on phase space A and B, so you can represent it in this form. So it's delta A, gamma ij, delta minus A goes to B. Okay, so then you can check. But this radial derivative, like so Hamilton's equations now, they can be written in this form. So we have that it's delta A, it's by delta pi ij. And this is the Hamiltonian that I wrote earlier. But now we can check that it can be written in terms of this Poisson bracket. With gamma ij, and then similar pi ij dot is minus delta h delta gamma ij, and this is minus h pi ij. Right. So now what we can do now is, well, for no good reason, let me just like define for now like some functional on phase space. So this is a vector that has like so it's a vector like on the manifold M, and then it's also a functional on this phase space, and I split it in this way. So it's some arbitrary function that is like the radial component of the vector plus xi I hi. So, and then what I can do is, so here is an exercise. So the claim is that this psi x then generates bulk diffeomorphisms with parameter psi tilde mu, which is the following. Psi r over n, and then here is psi I minus psi r n I over n. So that is, if you compute the Poisson bracket with gamma ij, it should give you that you get gamma ij, and then it's for pi ij. So you know, I mean, you know these are like tensor fields, like, so you can compute how they transform our diffeomorphisms independently, but then you can also check as an exercise like that if you compute the Poisson bracket of this constraint here with the corresponding field, you will generate the corresponding diffeomorphism where the parameters now are these expressions here.
Delta of, is a diffeomorphism of gamma ij. What is on the right hand side of this?
Yeah, so this is like psi tilde. So psi tilde is this. So the point is that, so here if you just introduce this psi, this vector psi in this in the constraint, the diffeomorphism is slightly modified. The parameter of the diffeomorphism is slightly modified. And it the parameter is this psi tilde. So it's psi r over n and psi I here minus psi r n I over n. So if you go to the Gaussian coordinates, then they coincide. But for non-Gaussian coordinates, they don't.
Is there a difference between Dirac brackets and this one here? Because you're doing a constant system?
Yeah, so here it's not Dirac brackets. So I will probably mention a bit later, like something about Dirac brackets. So this is like just the Poisson bracket. It's not the Dirac bracket. So, and then you can also compute the algebra . So, namely, take these two constraints of this form. Then you will find that indeed it closes. So you can also write it. So if you take like two constraints of this form, you take the Poisson bracket, you will find that you can express the right-hand side as a constraint of this form again, but with different parameters, where now psi, this psi double prime. It has some complicated expression, but it's important to write it down for a reason that I will mention. Minus so this is the radial component, and the other components are and then there is this other term. JXAR prime. Right, so this is like the radial component of this new vector, and this is the transverse component. But now you see here we have an issue, namely this covariant derivative appears, and the covariant derivative depends on the Christoffel symbol. The Christoffel symbol depends on gamma. So the structure constraints are filled dependent. So that's why like the algebra of diffeomorphisms is not a standard like Gates algebra. So there is this issue here. I'm not going to discuss it more now, but we will see that like we can bypass it, like I mean in a way that I will mention. Okay, so that's all I had to say like about the generic kind of Hamiltonian formulation of gravity. So next I'm going to go like to asymptotically ADS like supergravities in asymptotically ADS space. Well, just pure gravity for now. Are there any questions? This line?
Second line.
Second line, here. Right, this is I, J, prime J. So the free parameter, I just wrote it J here. I mean, it's so it's Xi. So if you want this Xi is Xi double prime R, and yes.
That's what it means.
Yeah, J, sorry. It's just like I parameterize in terms of J. Right, okay, so now let's discuss this reduced I will only go to the gravity part here, but you can extend the whole thing. Maybe I can do it a little bit like, I mean, in the next lecture. So now what I want to discuss here, first of all, is like the structure of the general asymptotic solutions. So asymptotically, ADS spaces, maybe I can also mention this like later more systematically. So they have a conformal boundary, and you can construct like the general asymptotic solutions of the equations of motion like in the vicinity of this boundary. So this is there is a huge literature on that. So like one way to do it is like we can pick a gauge. So I'm going to put n to 1 and ni equal to 0. So remember, these are Lagrange multipliers. They're non-dynamical, so I can decide to fix the mass as I want. So and then typically, this is called like the Pfefferman Graham gauge. So in these gauges, and I'm going to set also like the ADS radius to 1. So in these gauges, we can write the metric in this form. Where this gamma ij takes the following form. So it's e to the 2r So this is the general structure. So here, now let's see. So this constant, well, not constant, like this leading term here is independent of the radial coordinate. So all the coefficients here are independent of the radial coordinate. So it's an asymptotic expansion in the radial coordinate. So this here is the boundary metric. And this arbitrary. So if you solve the equation of motion, so this can be one way to determine this is just plug like an expansion of this form, just plug it into the equation of motion, and then you will determine these coefficients. But there is no constraint on this leading coefficient here. So it's completely general. It's arbitrary. Right. So now these other coefficients, so this G2 ij up to this HD. Ij are local curvatures of G0. So in particular, like G2 here is like it's the Ricci curvature. And then like the higher you go, you get higher order curvatures like of the boundary metric. And finally, so also this GD here, so I should also mention that, I'll just write here. So HD So I'll just finish this. So HD is non-zero if and only if D is even. Remember, the bulk dimension is D plus one. So that means D even means like odd dimensional ADA space. So otherwise, this H is zero. Okay, so was there a question?
Can you just write it?
Yes.
Can you just read the last three lines?
Yeah, can you please read it?
Oh, okay, I see. This line is here?
Yeah, okay, even the one before, yeah. So e to the 2r.
Yeah, so this one, I'm going to write this again. So this e to the 2r, g0ij, and then it's like g2ij, etc.
And then the bracket closed, right?
So.
Is the bracket closed?
So this close is here. Yes, indeed, there's another bracket. Thank you. So Samir, is this line clear?
Yeah.
Okay, so will we write the other two? So G2 up to H Dij are local curvatures. Yes, but curvatures, I mean also like diffeomorphism, covariant quantities, so I will explain like what I mean. So EG is proportional to R of G0, so Rij of G0. Then G4 goes like to Rij, let's say Rik, G0, Rk, J, G0, plus other terms of this form, this kind of. Sorry, is it okay? Right, and then finally for GD, so the other thing that I said is that HDij is non-zero if and only if D is even. This applies in the case of pure gravity. So if there is matter fields, this is not always true, although like sometimes it's stated like that. So
G2, I think, HD, what is that, KB or H, what is that?
Sorry for my handwriting. Like, so this is HD,
yes.
IJ.
And local curvatures of?
That was a mistake. So local curvatures of G0. Sorry. Right, and finally, GD is arbitrary up to two constraints. So now the constraints, I'm going to write them in a compact and implicit form, so they take this form. So this is the covariant derivative with respect to the metric G0. And then the trace of this, or the stress tensor, well, of this quantity, is some local function, where Tij is defined to be Ij minus right, and this so these terms here, so let me just write this in red. So again, these constraints, so GD satisfies, like it's arbitrary, but it has to satisfy these two constraints. But now this form of this A and X, so A is some local function that depends locally on the metric, so it's kind of like derivative, like derivatives, but in a covariant way. And then this Xij, it's a symmetric tensor, again, local in G0. But the precise expression of this depends on the particular dimension. So if you do it like in two dimensions, you will get something. So in two dimensions, this would be the Ricci curve, for sure. So in higher dimensions, it's something more complicated. And then again, here, you get some particular like tensor that depends on G0. And again, it's dimension dependent. So, yes.
So maybe maybe you can summarize in a sentence. So what is the original symplectic space? What is the reduction, the symmetry that you're using is just the radial? And what is your reduce?
So I didn't specify the reduced phase space yet. So before I was just like doing some preliminary like setup, like I mean for the Hamiltonian formulation. So now I'm going to use, so here I'm describing just the general asymptotic solutions of like ADS gravity, right? So this is just like by solving the equation of motion. So there are more fancy ways of doing it, but you can just get what I said here in this board now just by solving asymptotically the equation of motion. There is nothing to it. I mean, just brute force. Yeah, just brute form solving the equation of motion. That's all, right? I mean, without knowing anything. So of course, it's not very efficient doing it that way, but you can do it. So and then you get these constraints as well. And then I'm just saying that like here, I just don't write explicitly because it depends on the dimension. So this A and Xij. So and it's some curvatures like, I mean, of G0. So now. Now comes the first important thing, which is like this, towards like this, what I call this reduced phase space. So now what I want to show is that, like, if you see now, this is like a space of asymptotic solutions. And then my first claim is that it inherits a non-trivial symplectic structure. So that's why I call it like a phase space. Right, so. Now recall that the omega that we determined before, and it was like this expression, so it satisfied omega dot is equal to zero, right? So this was like independent of the particular radial slice, assuming the slice is compact. So now this means that we can just plug in the asymptotic expansions that I told you, right? I mean, that I just erased, just by brute force, use the expressions that we know from the Hamiltonian formulation to just like get something, like just plug it into this expression and see what we get. And of course, you need all the coefficients up to this order GD that I mentioned. So if you do this, what you find is that on this reduced phase space, omega becomes, so I will explain this notation in a moment. So this is defined to be minus a half Tij. And then this Tij, remember, it's this expression here. Like, so it's related to Gd, that is this particular combination. So you see, first of all, that indeed is independent of the radial coordinate, so as expected. And secondly, we see that T and G0 are symplectic conjugate variables. So now we have like this space of asymptotic solutions with a non-degenerate symplectic form on them. And from here, you can go on and define like again a Poisson bracket. So I'm going to define this and then stop. So we have like G0ij of x, and then pi dkl of x.
So can I also conclude that for all other variables that were under expansion, there would be an appropriate bracket because it follows from G0?
Which other terms?
So you have now G2, G4, up to GD.
Ah, yes, but this is crucial. So let me just write down the symplectic form, and I will come back to this point. So right. So this is now the symplectic, the Poisson bracket that follows from this symplectic form, and then we can realize it again in a similar way as before. So now this is like the space, the symplectic space we're working on is this space of this reduced phase space of solutions. Okay, so next time I'm going to discuss the symmetries like of this reduced phase space, and then like how all this is connected to field theory. But for now, let me just like answer Leo's comment and then stop. So so what happens is like if you plug these expansions that I mentioned, right? I mean with the G2, etc. So it is crucial that these are like local expressions in terms of G0, right? So because they are local expressions in terms of the G0, you can write them. So you see that. Here, it will cancel with the corresponding terms from here. So it's a non-trivial exercise, so you can just do it. But I mean, you can see that the fact that the higher order coefficients, like G2, for example, G4, et cetera, are local functions of G0, if you put them in the symplectic form and you take the corresponding product here, like I mean, with the variation of the metric G0, for example, the symplectic product, the variation, I mean, is zero. So the only non-zero terms you get is like when you hit like from one of the expansions of, so you get terms here, right? I mean, both of these get expanded. So, and from here, let's say you get like delta GD, and then here you get like delta G0. You also get the cross term, so it's like delta G0 from here, and delta GD from here. So, but these are the only cross terms that survive in this expansion. And the crucial ingredient in this, in showing this, is that the intermediate terms are all local as functions of G0. And that's why the symplectic form does not get contributions from those, which is also why it is actually finite. It is independent of the radial cutoff. OK, thank you.